Bishop Simon Gordon is the senior pastor of Tridestone Church of Chicago and the Midwest Regional Bishop for the Full Gospel Baptist Church Fellowship International. Bishop Gordon is the chairman of Total Resource Community Development Organization, a community-based entity, along with its subsidiary, Pastors for PCORE, which partners with the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, Northwestern University, and several major hospitals to provide health research training to churches. Bishop Gordon, who is a former city commissioner, works as a consultant for several companies and an advisor to Illinois political leaders on policy and community activities. Bishop Gordon has also authored 5 books and is a national music recording artist. Full Gospel, please welcome Bishop Simon Gordon.
We need to hear from you, Lord. Send your word. Oh, 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 oh. Send your word. Send your word. Send your word. We need to hear from you. Send your word, send us a awesome word, send a mighty word. Oh, we need to see it from you. Send your word. Oh, send it. Anybody ask, I need God to send me something I need to hear just from you. Send your word. Send your word. Send your word. We need to hear from you. Send your word. Send us a holy word. A healing word. Oh, oh, oh. We need to hear from you. Send your word. Come on, sing it with me. Lord, send your word. We're calling on you from all over. From the north, south, east, and west. We're yielding our hearts and our souls. Lord, we're looking for your very best. Send your anointing. Lord, send your holy power. Lord, bless your people. This very hour, fill us, Jesus. Come on and fill us, Lord. Oh, keep us, Jesus. Pour on us, Holy Spirit. We need to hear from you. We need to hear from you. We need to hear from you. We need to hear from you.
Somebody give God a hearty hand clap of praise right there. In this time we have to share with you for these few minutes, I want to take a look at a couple things that may be important in this 30th year. I know God has a word. Look down your oral and say, God's got a word for us tonight. It's important for us to grab it and to go with it and have it and use it in our lives. Listen, there's an old adage that says, he who forgets his history is subject to repeat it. But many of us don't often continue the phrase. The phrase ends by saying, he that studies and embraces his history is subject to improve it. And often what we miss is that we don't pay attention long enough. Because when God gives us thoughts, it's our obligation, first of all, to dare to think the thought. And next after that is our obligation to dare to finish the thought we were thinking about. To trust God and what he was saying to us. Some 30 years ago, some of us who attended the consecrations of most of our founding fathers were drafted into rooms under the direction of Bishop Andy Luther. And while we were drafted together, we were doing it as Bishop Morton was laying out what God gave him for this fellowship. And our job was to extract for presentation for the council from his messages that which will eventually become our fellowship distinctives. And so we spent weeks after weeks. I went to Bishop Malone's, I went to Bishop Ulmer's, I went to Bishop Larry Leonard's, I went down the line, all of these, listening to our bishop preach. And we went into rooms and extract and came up with distinctives to present back that Bishop Luther would present back. We had, first of all, Bishop talked about the usage of biblical titles for leaders. And then he laid out how important it was for us to accept women in ministry. He spoke to the fact that then we should also include an emphasis on the gifts of the Spirit. And he spoke of laying on hands with using anointing oil for impartation as well as for healing. But then there was one that really kind of stuck with me that I want to talk about today that seems to be the thread of how we've lasted for 30 years until now. And that was the last one that dealt with intentional praise and worship. The whole deal is that what God puts in us is what life expects from us. I need somebody to talk to somebody and say, what God puts in us is what life expects from us. God put some things in us so that we can be who he wants us to be in the earth. And the emphasis from our founder was that as a fellowship, it is important for us to have the ambience, the atmosphere, and the presence of worshipers at every level. Praying worshipers, preaching worshipers, singing worshipers, teaching worshipers, ushering worshipers, hospitality worshipers, counting money worshipers, armor bearing worshipers, to make sure that we kept worship as the theme of where we were. This is why our text today is coming from Psalm 95 that says, oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. Am I talking to myself or someone in this room? For the Lord is great and a great king above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. But here's the one I want to land at. Verse 6 says, oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. I want to talk to you by repeating my phrase again. What God puts in us is what life expects from us. I need you to talk to somebody and tell them worship is in you. That's what I want to talk about. Look at your neighbor and say, worship is in you. Now give God a hearty hand clap of praise in here as we move to our dialogue. One of the statements I'd like to start our commentary with is that the key to life is a life of worship. The key to life is a life of worship. Worship comes from the word worth. We treat with respect and care what we reverence and who we esteem with awe. You see, God gave us worship so we will be able to have what we need to properly access Him. The only way we can get to where we need to be is that we got to have some worshiping people. Won't you look at your neighbor and say, are you one of those worshiping people here? Because that's got to be something in us. God helps us get into our place for our miracle by hiding our blessings in our integrity and placing our benefits in our righteous actions. Then this requires us to live His way and receive these two things. The first one is the finest of our blessings, and the second one is the greatness of our benefits. And then He puts His own demand on how we regard Him. And He said in John 4:24, he that worship me must worship me in spirit and in truth. You see, I'm living a life of worship, and I'm living to worship Him. Because worship, somebody say it again in the room, worship is in me. Worship is in me. I got the statement to make regarding this that teaches us to pay attention to worshiping God does not prove that I am perfect. Worshiping God proves that I know and recognize that I need God to get better and to be better. The real deal is the reason I worship is because God is the authority in my life. And there are three truths about worship from a theological and practical origin. The first one is that God is an infinite being of excellence and worth. The second one is that man owes Him special reverence. And the third one is that God is man's first cause by giving him being and all that he is. So because of this, every man owes God special service. For that body that we house, that houses our lives, we need to be telling God, I'll do what you want me to do. For the ears that work, and for the eyes that see, for the legs that move, and for the hands and the fingers that can make motion, God puts us in a posture to understand that He's our last end and our highest good. And in Him alone can we find peace and joy. And because of this, we owe God a special love. You see, sometimes you gotta love God like you don't love anything else. You can't let anything get in the way of God when it comes to your relationship with Him. That's why we who know Him are obligated to worship Him. Yeah, and when we become aware of our dependency on Him. I can't speak for everybody, but I wonder if there's a few people on your road you don't mind telling and saying to them, I need Him. Can anybody in this side don't mind telling your neighbor, I need Him. It does not matter whatever else I'm going through, whatever my situation is, how much I have, how much I don't have, where I might go, the things that's going on. The fact is, I need Him. And because I need Him, I realize that I got to give Him the homage that's due His name. I believe that worship is the thread that's taken us from 30 years to now. You see, non-rational creatures, like certain primarily instinctive creatures, pay their debt to God by their dependence and natural existence. They have no intellects to recognize their need for Him, but their loyalty is directed to their survival patterns that support their mutual existence. I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, but I don't think I've ever read where all dogs go to heaven. The deal is that non-rational creatures don't have the same benefits that we have. But rational creatures, such as we, are capable of understanding that we have a debt to God. We only have to be willing to pay it. I wish there was somebody say, I need him and I owe him. The fact is that God's been so good to me that every time I think about it, something ought to happen within me and make me realize I did not make it by myself. When I look at this, that I need him, I need to tell you that everybody worships something. And if you want to know what somebody really worships, just watch and observe what they are attracted to when they're in trouble. Because when trouble comes, people run to who they think is going to make a difference in their life. But if you know that God is your answer, if you know that God is your way maker, if you know that God is your deliverer, if you know that God is your friend, something on the inside ought to come up on the outside of you and make you stand up and say, in God I live and in God I die. I'm going to praise God with everything I have. Someone shout glory there. I recognize that I owe him. I also recognize at the same time that I cannot fully pay him. As much as I can give, I cannot give enough. As much as I can do, I cannot do enough. As much as I can serve, I cannot serve enough. As far as I can go, I cannot go far enough. The deal is I need God to show up in my beginning. He lets me in my vision see my end at my beginning so I can work toward it. Then he puts me in a posture so I can begin to pay attention to the fact that he got his hand on my situation. And as I have my successes, I pay attention to the fact that it is God who's leading me, directly keeping me and put me in a place to be successful. Who wouldn't worship a God? I feel the Holy Ghost. Like that. God is incredible in the way that he handles us. And he gives us chance to recognize that it's not all about our circumstances. This is why I'm convinced that we should internally prepare to worship God. How shall I internally prepare? Well, let's start first by saying at some point we got to stop being so busy and we got to be still. I need somebody to look at your neighbor and say, just be still, be still. We got to deliberately calm our heart, our mind, our soul, our emotions and our appetites and activities and trust God that he knows what to do about our situation. And matter of fact, Peter said this way, he says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God that he might exalt you, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. The deal is that God is not messed up over what you care about. He gets messed up over the care that you care about it. It becomes exceedingly important for us to begin to shift the way we look at life and recognize that God is our answer. Be still. The next thing we ought to do, if we're going to get there, we got to be quiet. Sometime understand that quiet requires study. Somebody talk to your neighbor and just tell them quiet requires study. That's why 1 Thessalonians 4 and 11 says, study to be quiet. He says, do your own business and work with your own hands. Then deliberately take some time to quiet yourself. Hush your emotions. Hush your feelings. Hush your opinions. And listen for God. Because sometimes you'll never concentrate until you get a little silence. I like Habakkuk. Talk, Habakkuk. He said, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Yes, yes, yes. Study. Be quiet. But the third one is, it's important that we offer the sacrifice of praise. Yes, sacrifice is to have a life of obedience that needs no announcement to identify solely with what it is when it comes to the way and the will towards Christ. It is a saying to God that I accept that you know what's right for me. And he answers back with Psalm 50 and 23, whosoever offereth praise will literally glorify me, and he who ordered his conversation aright, to him will I show my salvation. Can I just make a statement to you today? Can I make a statement to you today? I don't hear nobody. Can I make a statement to y'all? Stop believing that you can love God thoroughly without giving him affection. I need you to talk to somebody. Just tell them, stop believing that you can love God thoroughly without giving him affection. Yeah, something inside of you. Because love without the mingling of the spirit and the soul is very unfulfilling. As a matter of fact, who you love, your affections act out with. And if you love God, every once in a while, your affections ought to be going haywire when you think about them. All folk used to say, when I think about the goodness of Jesus. Y'all can finish it. My soul shouts hallelujah because I thank him for all he's done for me. It's my affection for God that keeps me driving to God. And when God honors my worship, my life then is blessed. Know that the purpose of worship is not just to meet your individual need, but it is to meet God's requirement for the life we live. God is saying, trust me and worship me. And then watch me bless you without your effort. Oh, y'all didn't hear me. I got to say it again. God is saying, let me try it over here. Trust me. And then worship me. And then watch me bless you without your effort. Well, somebody over here need to get what I'm saying. He says here, I need you to trust me. And then watch me. And watch me bless you without you. I can turn things around that you cannot see. I heard the scripture say, I have not seen, ear have not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of man what God has in store for you. God can bless you. Understand, if you trust God and when you worship him, you can do this next thing. I'm about to watch God answer my prayer. I need some of y'all to tell three people, say, I'm about to watch God answer my prayer. I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing, but I'm about to watch God answer my prayers. Why you not tow up? I'm watching God. I'm about to watch God answer my prayer. Why you not upset? I'm about to watch God answer my prayer. Why you not disturbed? I'm about to watch God answer my prayer. Why you hanging on like that? Well, I'm about to watch God answer my prayer. Why you believe in that kind of healing? I'm about to watch God. Answer my prayer. God is so phenomenal in the way that he takes us care of us. All that we do, we have to remember how important it is to worship him. Somebody here, talk to your neighbor, say, we got to give him worship. Now, to help us with the process, he teaches in the Old Testament methodology and practice so that because they did not have the Holy Spirit inside of them to be the motivation, they were moved as they by the Holy Spirit as the words of the Lord was prophetically given to them. It then is important that God gave Israel specific tools to use to fashion their lives in the image of worshipers. Mm-hmm. Now, the Torah teaches us to keep paying attention to and longing for God. I like Deuteronomy 11 because it's so powerful. But Deuteronomy 11, verses 13 and 14, he's talking to Israel and says, I know you don't have nothing on the inside because the way you act and you prove that you don't have nothing on the inside. So let me tell you, there's some things you can start doing if you give your life and heart over me, and it shall come to pass if you will hearken diligently to my commandments, which I command you this day. To love the Lord thy God and to serve the Lord with all of your heart and with all of your soul. And verse 14 is summarized by saying, and I'll bless you. Mm-hmm. Three proofs that show up that worship is working in you. The first one is God is saying, you should be hearing me by now. Go on, ask your neighbor, say, how long you been in church? Go on. God is saying, you should be hearing me by now. You shouldn't need every prophet to tell you what to do. You should be hearing me by now. How dare you have listened to the word Sunday after Sunday and you turn around and act like I haven't been talking to you? You need to understand. You should be hearing me by now. And don't you tell me that you've grown out of this church when you never grew up in it. You should be hearing me by now. So he lays it out and he talks to them in Deuteronomy to make sure they have clarity. You see, understand, when you hear him from the depth of our imagination to the height of our revelation, worship should begin to reign by our behavior and our practice by our relationship with him. We should understand that we automatically should live a worshipful life. We go after God without being provoked. When the last time all you need to hear was Jesus? When is the last time you were driving in your car and all you could hear Jesus? When was the last time you was walking down the hallway in your house and all you could hear Jesus? When is the last time God started speaking in your spirit? You couldn't help yourself. You felt something. You didn't know all that was going on. This is not the time for this, God. Oh, but I got you. Jesus, he'll pop up because he ought to interrupt you at some time. He ought to make you look at and do some things you didn't plan to do today. He ought to hook you up with a divine opportunity to see his excellence and feel his presence and step into the ecstasy that he's designed only for those who have a legitimate relationship with him. Something in you ought to want him like you never wanted him before. If you ever tasted it, you ought to want it again. So worship must be inclusive of life's mannerisms. This means our personal life. This means our public life, our private life, and our civic life. Because worship is not just an introspective experience, only in part, but it's mostly an outwardly driven emotion and intelligent examination of an inward awe, a gratitude and an adoration that literally compels us to enter into a divine, indescribable affection towards God, who is our maker. God, when you got God in your heart, sometime you just can't help it. And he puts us in that particular posture here. When you find it, you'll discover you were created for it. And then in worship, you'll find out that's how I shift my atmosphere. You want to talk about shifting the atmosphere? I dare you to worship him. And you can shift an atmosphere if you just worship him. I dare you to go ahead and give. Sometimes it's good to lay on your face. I'll come to that in a few minutes here. Every time we worship God, we shift our own atmosphere into a position where God can release miracles for us, both simple and great. And receiving a miracle without praising God for it is divine disrespect. So it becomes our obligation to take our worship away from our possessions, take it off of our adornment, take it off the car, out of the makeup and off the hair and the nails, and take it from the clothes and the shoes, and put it in our heart and push it toward God. Time for us to lift up God with everything we have. Because the more you recognize how God provides for your outward condition and for your ease and your convenience, the more we would abound in his service. J. Vernon McGee makes this statement when he says, the less we have to do with our bodies, the more we should do for God with our souls. So he sets us up in quite a unique and wonderful way. I love the way God does it, because understand, your atmosphere will support your living full if worship is in your process. You can't live full without some worship. It's got to be in the midst of all that you do and where you stand, because if you'll lift him up, God is never in the business of disappointing our praise but inhabiting it. Mm-hmm. The deal is that the benefit of your praise is that every time you praise God, you make the devil deal with your testimony again. Somebody here, tell your neighbor, it's about time for the devil to deal with your testimony. Every time you lift him up, the devil got to deal with the fact what God keeps doing for you. Every time you talk about it, how good God is, the devil have to live with your testimony. Every time you get a chance, you ought to make the devil live with your testimony again. As a matter of fact, if you praise him enough, you'll restrict the devil's access to your blessing. I can better see help in God, and I can better see help from God when I finally see God as my help. That's the way that works. And all of this points to our text today. I know y'all's going, when are you going to get to that text? My introduction is over now, so I can get to the text. If God does all of this for us, it should not be hard for us to worship him. Psalm 40, 16 says, let all those that seek thee rejoice and be glad in thee. Let such as love thy salvation continually say, the Lord be magnified. Oh, live to worship. Because worship is living in you. Interesting here that this psalm starts off with a one-letter word that causes us to grab attention. He says, oh. Can I get an oh in the room? It's an alarming word. It's a specific word that makes us get to a point to recognize something is coming after this that we need to pay attention to. It says, oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. I like this. Lord, this messed me up because what this taught me right from the beginning is you got a song in you. I wish you'd talk to somebody on both sides and say, you got a song in you. When the last time you start singing your own song that God had in you for your circumstances that you wrestling with, that you fighting with, that you've been trying to go, oh, you got a song in you. You got to let that song out. You just can't sing it in the shower where the only place you think you sound good. You got to sing it everywhere you go. You got a song in you. He opens this thing up and says, oh, gives us a chance. Let us sing it to the Lord and make a joyful noise. Psalm 47 and 6 says, sing praises unto our God. Sing praises unto our King. That's a bit of psalmist in all of you. Listen, just for your song to work, all you need are these simple little qualities for a song. You need intervals and patterns. You need to sync with tempo and timing. You need to add cadence and expression, and then sprinkle in a little of your testimony. You'll fool around and get a melody out of that. The whole deal is when you talk about the intervals, it's the life spacing, what it took you from to get to here to get to there. When you talk about patterns, you're talking about your life habits, the things that you have to do and shift and change them so you become who you are, so you become who you want to be and be who God says you should be. Tempo and timing deals with your life journey. I was there, but now I'm here, but I'm going there because he promised me over there. Then it took me in the point to pay attention to looking at the end of this thing and recognize that I also have some cadence and expression. This is where I am in my life story right now, and my testimony tells the story of where my words and my journey have relationship. Sing your song, but don't leave your song without your heart and mind and soul deliberating and acknowledging God for who he is. With every song, there should be something ringing in your heart saying, I'm glad he saved me. Is there anybody here who can say, I'm glad he saved me? When we get to that point, we recognize we didn't make it by ourselves. I love him because I like the way he keeps making ways for me. It's my love for him that has me in the posture, in the place, and in the realm that I am in this particular time in life. God keeps making a way for me. Somebody help me. Just tell your neighbor, God keeps making a way for me. When I see this, when I handle this, when I pay attention to this, I keep recognizing that God is doing some wonderful things in my life. You see, it's my love for him that makes me thank him continually. That's why verse 2 says, let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. But that's not all. Listen here, come before his presence with singing. Psalm 102 says, you got to find a thankful song that you sing along with your dialogue. And to make a joyful noise unto him with psalms in the B clause of verse 2. History records that theologians grabbed hold of this particular part of verse 2 and begin to use it to kind of finalize and demonstrate how important it is to take the song and actually go along with it. Let's read that again. And make a joyful noise unto him with psalm. You see, and Ananias calls the psalms the epitome of all scripture. Basil calls the psalms, it is a common treasure of all good precepts, the voice of the church and the compendium of theology. Ambrose deals with the fact or declares that law and instructions and history informs and prophecy predicts and correction centers and morals exhort. But in the Psalms, you find the fruit of all these things as well as a remedy for the salvation of your soul. St. Augustine says, get you a psalm scene now, because Augustine declares that the Psalms are educational. For what is there that cannot be learned in the Psalms? Martin Luther jumps in and said, don't leave me out. He says, listen here, one verse in the Psalms is sufficient for the meditation of the day. And he who at the end of the day have found himself fully possessed of his sense and spirit may consider his time well spent. Can I do a couple more? Gerhardt, he says, and he proclaims that the Psalms are a theater where God allows us to behold both himself and his works. They are most pleasant green field, a vast garden where all manner of flowers are a paradise, having the most delicious fruits, a great sea which has great costly pearls there, a heavenly school, a divine mirror of grace, a compendium of all scripture, reflecting the face of God's loving and heavenly Father to the anatomy of our soul. And then John Calvin says, can I get in on this? Yes, come on, Calvin. He says, there is no other book in which are recorded as many deliverances that we find in the psalm. No one can pick out the evidences of the fatherly providence and solicitude that is celebrated with the splendor of diction and with the strictness of adherence to the truth. He sits it out. Now, worshipers, that's what they said. My question to you is, what you say? Ask your neighbor, say, what you say about the song? Go on, ask what you. Because for some of us, I'm wondering if you really have a favorite psalm. Can I run through a couple of them? Maybe I might get to yours. Psalm 1 kind of opens up by giving us an opportunity to say, if it's your favorite, I just need you to join in with me. He starts off by saying, blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in it doth he meditate both day and night. What's going to happen for him? And he shall be. And he shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water that bringeth forth fruit in this season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Okay, that wasn't yours. Let me try another one here. For the things you fell into, but you needed some praise and worship to get you out of. Let me try this one. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He lead me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. He lead me beside the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And sometimes I got to go through a difficult time. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not going to fear any fear evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You got to deal with your enemies? Yes. He prepared a table for me. It was just me and my enemies there. He prepared a table for me in the presence of my enemies. But I'm the only one that the table got anointed with oil. And because he anointed me, surely, goodness and mercy. Somebody in the room ought to help me just say surely in here. goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Wait, hold on. That wasn't some of y'all's song. I need to try one more. If you know that you owe God, maybe this psalm is for you. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. From whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies, come upon me to eat up my flesh. They stumbled and fell. Though a host shall encamp against me. Is that your psalm? Am I getting to anybody's psalm yet? Yeah. My heart shall not fear. The war shall rise up against me. In this will I be comforted, because one thing have I desired of the Lord, and I'm going to keep on seeking after it, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty and to inquire in his temple. Why? Because in the time of trouble, in the time of trouble, he shall hide me. Tell somebody, he'll hide you. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. I love this thing. He shall set me on a rock, and now my head shall be lifted up above my enemy. Wait, hold on. You hide me and exposing me at the same time, but telling me I'm blessed and I'm all right. I may as well go ahead and give you some glory here. Maybe I didn't get to yours. Let me just try one more. I know I owe him. And Charles Spurgeon says that owing God is a debt, and it must be paid. So why? Because if for us keeping a relationship with him, for him holding us and healing us, for him loving us and blessing us, you see, you can give money, but that won't be suffice to cover your worship. You can prophesy, but that couldn't cover your worship. You can use your best testimony, but that wouldn't cover your worship. You see, Spurgeon says, owing God is a debt, and the only way you handle your debt is you need to pay it. Well, what kind of debt is it? Well, Spurgeon says, everybody ought to pay their rent. I came to tell you, God's been good to you, and something based upon how good God has been to you, ought to make you pay your rent. Psalm 134, it says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of and be glad. Don't make me do this by myself, but oh, magnify. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. You see, I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all of my fears. They looked upon him and were lightened. Their faces were not ashamed, but this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his trouble. The angel of the Lord encampeth around them that fear him, and said, can I get somebody to go with me? Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusted him. So my statement to you is, don't just come together, but I want you to glorify him together. I want you to look down your rent roll and say, neighbor, I got enough worship in me to worship for everybody on this roll. I got enough praise in me to praise for everybody that's on this roll. Whatever miracle needs to take place, whatever blessing that needs to happen, I know that God can make something wonderful begin to happen. And if I trust God, God will step into my situation and start blessing like I've never seen it happen before. What should I do? Yes, make a joyful noise, all ye lands. Now that's not a saying psalm, that's a doing psalm. So let me try it again. Make a joyful noise, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. He hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and enter into his courts with praise. Be unto him and bless his holy name. Why are you gonna be like that? Because the Lord is good. Can I help you? Can somebody just find three people and say, the Lord is good? Every time I think about it, I recognize I'm here because of his goodness. The Lord is good. The Lord is good. And his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. You see, you can't praise him without your passion, and you can't worship him without your affection. So what are you waiting for? Listen here, when I look at how good God is and how has always been, I learn to understand I gotta give him glory every chance I get. And if I can't shout over what I see, I'm gonna shout over what I believe. I believe God can do it. I believe God can answer. I believe God can come through. I believe God can turn it around. He tells us in the sixth verse, oh come, let us worship and bow down. Hold on a minute. He said bow down. When he said bow down, that means I can't see no more. When he said bow down, I need somebody to lead me. When he said bow down, I need him to be my guide. When he said bow down, the reason I bow, I trust God with my future. I trust God with the fellowship. I trust God with my life. I trust God with the church. I begin to understand there's a time to bow in worship, because bowing represents I'm willing to break my back for what I say I believe. But whatever you learn from that sermon, I've also learned that it's dangerous to stand up where you need to be bowing, because you might get crushed. The deal is that God will place you right where he wants to bless you. So here is our declaration. Just as you can't enjoy being happy if happiness is not attractive to you, just as you have to enjoy enjoyment if you want the pleasure out of it, just as you have to submit to peace if you want to have peace, you also have to surrender to worship if you want the presence of God. Now, some of y'all been watching me the whole time I've been preaching, but I'm telling you, it's your turn now. I've already dropped the word. Now it's your time to lift him up. I've learned this about God, that listen, nobody can make you get it. You gotta want it for yourself. When I look at this, I saw one more verse that I couldn't leave out. Psalm 96 and 9 says, oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Hallelujah, fear before him. All ye earth, listen here, worshiping makes a worshiper become one with the object of his worship. But there's a difference between praise and worship. When you praise the Lord, understand this. Praise can be mimicked, but worship can't be faked. Just like the woman with the issue of blood, who said, but if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole. I'm living to worship him, because worship is in me. Why you lift him up like that? Why I lift him up? Because of what it brought me through, and because of what it keeps doing. The hymn that said, why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. me. His eye. Oh, his eye is on the sparrow. I know he watches me.